Hello, we're here. You want to take a little bit?
I'll do my official little thing here.
Yes.
Hi, everyone. We're back, in case you're wondering, from the little tiny break. And if you're out there in HowlRound land, if you don't know where we are, it's NoPassport Conference at LSU. Oh my God, what am I saying? It's a long day already. This is Getty Dadsmith, and I'm the founder of NoPassport, and I'm a playwright. We are here for this panel, which is The Katrina Effect, Performance Response to Gulf Coast Man-Made Disasters. And it's led by Anneliese Fox, and she'll walk you through it.
Thanks. So I'm a recent graduate here in the doctoral program of theater here at LSU, and my doctoral research was on Katrina performances after the levee break disaster that were responding to it through personal story, site-specific, and memory. And so this panel is, I'm very excited to be able to have this table here. And with the time we have, what I wanted to do is give more time for our artists to speak. Everyone here has a lot of, they're very committed artists with a lot of accomplishments. And we have seven projects on the table. And the man-made disasters that we call into the room are the Katrina levee break disaster of 2005, and almost 5 years after that, the BP oil spill and Deep Horizon explosion in 2010, and then this enduring over many decades and long-term issue of coastal loss and culture loss in Louisiana Gulf Coast. So I'm going to just very quickly give a pass around. Well, I would like to start with John Biguenet. He's a university professor of English at Loyola University. He's a multi-genre published author, and as well as a distinguished playwright, and he has written a trilogy of plays called Rising Water that are in direct response to the Katrina levee breaks disaster. The first one came out in 2006. It's Rising Water 7. It's written in 06. And that was taking place in the middle of the flooding. The next play, Shotgun, takes place 4 months into the disaster. And then the final play, Mold, which premiered last spring, takes place as we approach the first year anniversary of the disaster. All three of these plays in the trilogy have received stagings around the nation, but as well as either a premiere or an important stage at Southern Rep Theater in New Orleans. And I'm going to let John later introduce more about the trilogy, and I'm going to try to very gracefully work with our technology to show a few little short clips. Then we move on to our next disaster, BP oil spill. we have with us three of the collaborators of this project. And of course, Spill is premiering here at Swine Palace at LSU right now, and part of our conference activity is to see this play if you haven't already seen it. And as Nick and I were saying this earlier today, that we feel like it is required viewing for all Louisiana residents. So Leigh Fondakowski, you might know her work more from the Laramie Project and the Tectonic Theater Project. She was a head writer of the Laramie Project, and also that has been staged all over the place and was also honored with an Emmy for the HBO adaptation of that play. And Reva Wortel, who is the portrait visual artist, but who did the portraits that accompany the drama, the play that hopefully you will see tonight. And a dramaturg as well as a performer with the Tectonic Theater Project, who an amazing performer that you will get to see, Kelly Simpkins.
Or Lily.
Thank you. You're so gracious. And with more of the even before the storm, Kathy Randels of ArtSpot Productions had been in the works to produce a site-specific piece dealing with coastal loss and land loss, and then the disaster happened, and very shortly thereafter was a production called Beneath the Strata, which was, I'll let her talk a little more about it. I'll be a little quiet. And, Kathy Randels started, she's the artistic director and founder of ArtSpot Productions, which is nearing its 20th year, based in New Orleans. Kathy is a Louisiana Theater Festival winner, fellow, and an OB performer and winner, and yes, been touring nationally, but based in New Orleans. Nick Slie is the co-artistic director and co-founder of Mondo Bizarro Performance Collective. Very bizarre. And he's with Bruce France. And he's also an LSU alum of the Performance Studies program. And the next piece that they Nick was an actor in Beneath the Strata, and then they collaborated more closely, the two organizations, with Lou Garou, which is a solo performance with a lot of other great minds behind it. And this final piece called Cry You One, which had a performance premiere in the fall in Violet, Louisiana, in St. Bernard Parish, where New Orleanians who wanted to see the show had to drive and about an hour and walk about a mile and a half, have a journey looking at the edge of our coast. And I'm going to let them talk more about these productions. So I'm going to try to very elegantly start these clips, and then we'll start with John. I have two mics, and where's the other mic? Okay, thanks. So we can be a little more elegant the way we pass. So this was some. You were a columnist for the New York Times in the immediate time after the storm, and then there was a couple of news pieces that you did for the New York Times.
Yes, my wife and son and I were homeless, and I wrote a piece about whether New Orleanians were evacuees or refugees. There actually was a debate in Congress about it. And the Times saw it and called my agent and said, we want him to become our first guest columnist, but he's got to go right back to New Orleans. And so we got to New Orleans the night martial law was lifted. And I began to file, although we were sleeping in a daycare center, I wrote column after column. I was shooting videos, and the columns I wrote on a little green 12-inch chair on top of a yellow 18-inch table in this daycare center after we spent the day gutting our house.
So I'm going to be, it gets into the power of, oh, look at me, of storytelling and sharing stories. So rather than, I'm going to show just the first 30 seconds, and then I'm going to try to get more into the plays, some of the video clips we have of the plays. So here we go.
Here is where it began, for those of us who live near Lake Pontchartrain. My neighborhood since childhood, a neighborhood now abandoned to the bulldozers of the Corps of Engineers. It's been a year now since defective levees here at the 17th Street Canal and elsewhere in New Orleans collapsed, flooding the city and killing 1,300. It's been a year now, but it feels like yesterday. What?
Sorry. Sorry to interrupt you there, but I want to move on. This is a clip from Rising Water, and John, do you want to talk a little bit about Rising Water before I show a clip?
One of the things that became very clear as I started to report for the Times was that the Corps of Engineers was lying about what had happened. There's a levee two blocks from my house. The Corps insisted that they'd been overtopped by floodwaters. In fact, it was clear that the levees had burst at the bottom. And forensic engineering studies later showed that while the Corps should have put 65 feet of steel in those levees, in some cases they used only 4.5 feet of steel. So it was nothing but mud holding back the engorged canals. And when they burst with such a force that in the lower Ninth Ward, a wall of water 18 feet high moved down the street at 5 feet a second. People didn't stand a chance. They cut houses, those walls of water cut houses in half, put trucks on top of rooftops. And so I began to think about what would have happened if my wife and I had stayed rather than evacuating and had been trapped in an attic. In my neighborhood, the water came up 8 feet in 10 minutes, and it came in the middle of the night. It takes a long time to fill up an area seven times the size of the entire island of Manhattan with salt water 16 feet deep. And so if you were near a levee, the water reached you probably Monday afternoon in daylight. But if you were 20 blocks away, and no one knew that this had happened, there were no reports on CNN until Tuesday morning, the water reached your house in the middle of the night, on Monday night, 12 hours or 14 hours after the hurricane had passed. You were awakened asleep with water 3 feet deep in your house already, and in the next 5 minutes it was going to rise another 6 feet. If you went outside to see what was happening, you drowned. If you were in a walker or too old to get up the attic stairs, you drowned in your bedroom. But if you got in the attic, that attic was going to reach 130 degrees the next day. And if you couldn't find a way to cut yourself onto the rooftop, you died of dehydration in the attic. And this play looks at a couple who are awakened in that fashion, first in the attic in the first act, and they break through in the second act onto the roof.
Play about storytelling, because that's a very New Orleans tradition. We get through things by telling each other stories. And this is what Biguenet does. He found a lot of stories, and he has made his own story, a composite of a lot of the stories that he was told.
Don't talk, foolish woman. You think God did this to us? This water is just somebody who didn't do his job. Somebody who made a terrible mistake and didn't care enough to set it right.
But that's even worse. God did this to us. You and me, we lost everything we owe. How many people do you think already dropped in their bedroom since the sun went down? And it's all because somebody cut some cords.
Biguenet says that this is a play about ordinary people in an extraordinary situation. And he thinks it's very fitting that it's being done at Southern Rapid Canal Place because people all over the world saw that building burning on CNN. He thinks it's another way that we can reclaim our city.
You can see the, since you're a theater group, I don't have to explain to you Happy Days by Samuel Beckett's influence on this play. And in fact, what had happened was that Beckett had created a vocabulary that we didn't really need for 50 years. But this play ran forever, basically, to full houses, almost from opening night. The other great theatrical success that year was Waiting for Godot. Classical Theater of Harlem, Wendell Pierce was behind that, came to New Orleans. They did one performance in the Lower Ninth Ward and one performance in Gentilly, two blocks from where my mother's house was destroyed, in fact. Both times, 3,000 or 4,000 people showed up to see it. And I can tell you, New Orleanians did not know who Samuel Beckett was. But when they heard about two people waiting for someone who doesn't show up, they knew it was a story about them.
Yes, that was the most, I think, the most successful play ever in Southern Reps Theater history.
Yeah, it was better than a musical, in fact. And the city only had a third of the population it did when it had set previous records for attendance. People understood it was something about themselves. And it really, it made me understand theater in a brand new way. I began to see a link between theater and cities, which I'd never recognized. I write novels, short stories, all sorts of things. And usually it's going to be read by people around the world. But in the case of a play, it's done by actors who have something of the English or the audience's English for a particular community, asking questions the community needs to address. When I went back to Euripides, Euripides was writing for his Athenian neighbors. Only one of Shakespeare's plays ever showed outside of London. Playwrights have written for their neighbors, phrasing questions the community needs to speak about. And I don't think there's another kind of narrative like that.
Okay, here's the one that kept spinning on mold, but it's a lovely piece that WGNO did to announce the premiere.
This is loading.
It's loading. It's going to happen.
A TV station came to film Rising Water, and the cameraman looked like a biker, bald head, tattoos, big shirt, 6'6". He started sobbing so hard he couldn't hold the camera steady when he was filming one of the scenes. And so they couldn't show a clip because he just couldn't hold it while the actors were going through their lines.
For this piece, Mold, this was the one that premiered, was it the premiere at Southern Rep last spring, 2013?
That's right. And it was set a year after the, I don't know if this is going to work or not, but it's set a year after the flood. A young couple that's been living in Texas come back to meet an insurance adjuster to see whether or not they can rebuild. It turns out the young man's parents' house, his parents have died in the attic. And one of the things we discovered is something I reported about on the Times, and one of my students told me about. Her boyfriend's aunt and uncle were trapped in an attic, and it became clear after a couple of days nobody was coming for them. And so they taped their driver's licenses to their bodies so that their bodies could be identified. And it turns out that's how his parents have died. And the young couple have got to decide, do we rebuild in New Orleans or do we make a new life somewhere else? Here it is. Perhaps.
I'm sorry, there's a little ad.
So you can deposit a check?
The
Sorry. I'm afraid to mute.
So you can't read the
blink of an eye.
I got it. The Chase mobile app, so you can't.
That's what y'all
have around. The boat is just floating around the water and then it sinks just like the Titanic.
You've never left a movie theater feeling what you're going to feel leaving this play. The immediacy of the human beings just a few feet away from you, going through some of the things that the audience itself has gone through, I think makes an experience that would never be duplicated on film.
Writer John Biguenet is at it again, this time making the last play in his trilogy about the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina come to life.
More is so much a part of our life, and I'm sure that many people walking into this theater simply looking at the set will begin to wheeze. This play is a kind of fitting culmination to the entire trilogy. It stands by itself, but it also knits together threads that began to unravel in the first two plays.
Mold is about a couple who evacuate a day before Katrina hit and come back home nearly a year later to deal with reality. It hits close to home for several New Orleanians, including Biguenet and actress Carol Sutton, who plays a woman who chose not to evacuate.
Seeing everything destroyed makes me wonder, just what I spent my money on and what I could have had.
Well, if you see this play, you'll see what my character has to go through. And when I think about not evacuating, if I would have stayed here, I may have had to go through the same thing. I don't know if I would have been as brave as she was. The two main characters, the emotions that they go through is fascinating to me. I wish I could tell you more, but you know, I just want people to come and see for themselves and they'll see what I'm talking about.
Rising Water, the first play in that trilogy, became Southern Rep's longest running and most successful show, and they expect similar results from this one. The show is now running. It runs till April 14th, and for tickets, just log on to wgno.com.
All right. So I think...
I might just say there's a kind of relationship between the Laramie Project and these plays in that I made up almost nothing. Carol Sutton plays a character who stays through the storm. The storm is long past, but the water starts to rise. And she's sitting on her sofa, and it starts to come up, as it did in my neighborhood, very, very quickly. She winds up standing on a chair for 24 hours. That story was based on something that someone said in a talk back at a matinee of Rising Water. It was Sunday afternoon. A lady that looked like my grandmother with her little white gloves on began to talk about what had happened to her, and she told the story of sitting in Gentilly, where I grew up, having to stand on a chair for 24 hours. The water came rushing in New Orleans, and then it sort of swept back, so the water lines that you would see were actually 2 feet lower than they actually were. It came down enough so that the next morning a man came by in a flatboat and said, "Is anybody still alive?" And she said, "I'm alive." And he said, "Well, can you swim?" "Ever since I was a little girl." And this is a lady telling us this story. And so she dove underwater, went through where her window had been blown out, popped up alongside his boat. He dragged her up onto the boat, gave her a beer, and she said, "And darling, that's when my trouble really began." So all three of these stories are almost entirely documentary, knitting together different stories, I think, the way Laramie Project did.
Can you talk about Shotgun? Give us a little intro to the middle play.
Well, Shotgun is about race. If you're not talking about race, you're not talking about New Orleans. And 4 months after the flood, something happened that transformed everything. Up to that point, all the old animosities disappeared or were put aside because we were all in so much trouble. If somebody was on the side of the road with a broken down car, you stopped and helped. And color, religion, nothing made any difference. You just helped somebody else in trouble. But our mayor, it was clear he was not going to be reelected, Mayor Nagin. He's on the verge of, I think, a 30-year prison sentence now for federal crimes. And he made it on Martin Luther King Jr. Day, a Chocolate City speech, in which he said white New Orleanians are conspiring to keep black New Orleanians from coming back to the city. And all the tension and anxiety we all were feeling just exploded. I was a child when the segregationists were losing power, and it was just as tense in those months after that speech as it was when integration was beginning to happen in the city. And I wanted to explore what happened. And in that play, a white man and his teenage son who have lost everything, including wife and mother, ran half of a shotgun duplex, we call them doubles, across the river in Algiers where it didn't flood, from a young African-American woman whose father's lost his house in the Lower Ninth Ward and moved in with her. The white man and the black landlady fall in love, and being New Orleans, everybody goes crazy. the father of the landlady at one point takes the white man aside and tries to convince him to give it up. And the white man says, but Dex, look at us. Here we are. Everything's changing. White family and a black family living under one roof? And the old man says, yeah, but with a wall running between us. And so I tried to examine what happened to race. So these three plays did, I hope, two things. One was to phrase questions that the community need to talk about, and we had to talk about race. We had to talk about what we were all feeling at that period. And we had to talk about, a year later, all those people who didn't come back. Only 350,000 people live in New Orleans now. 500,000 lived there before the flood. So there are 150,000 living somewhere in the United States that aren't coming home. So that play was partly about that. But the other thing, and I think this is true of all of us, was to get the story out and keep it alive. These plays have had 30 or 40 productions around the United States from coast to coast. And at talkbacks, the audience always says exactly the same thing. I had no idea that's what happened in New Orleans. I thought it was a hurricane. And so I think we're all working very hard to make clear what happened, because as I always argue, New Orleans is simply where the future arrived first. If you don't take care of the environment, you don't take care of the poor, you don't take care of public education, you let public corruption thrive, you get New Orleans in 2005.
Thank you. That's a really great lead-in for the next project, the Spill project that's currently running.
Thank you. That was such a moving presentation. Still kind of in digesting it. Yes, I agree. I think you so articulately stated sort of one of the fundamental basis of all the work that I've done, which is ordinary people in extraordinary circumstances. And, you know, the tragedy that you didn't mention in my brief bio, I did work on the Laramie Project, and then I also spent 5 years studying the deaths in Jonestown, the 1978 Jonestown tragedy, and then moved on to the BP oil spills. So yeah, but the question of what do we do with all that grief, and what do we do with all that trauma? And I've made it a point in my work to bring the story back to that community. So in you know, the way I my worldview of the American theater, I would go to the regional theater that was closest to the event that I was studying. So in Laramie, the closest regional was Denver Center, and that's where we premiered Laramie. In the case of the Jonestown piece, many of the people who died in Jonestown and the people who survived came from the Bay Area. So we premiered that play at Berkeley Rep. And in the case of Spill, we were dedicated to premiering it here in Louisiana, and so we approached Swine Palace, which was the closest regional to a lot of our interviewees. But it is, the theater does become a place to bring all that grief and bring all that trauma, and not that we can provide a resolution to these events, but I think through the act of making art from the tragedy, hopefully there is some way that human suffering is addressed. I don't want to say that it heals it, but I think it touches upon the unresolved places within a community and within the individuals. So I'll pass the mic to my collaborators. They can touch on some other things. Well, we're going to see it. I'm very moved by this idea of grief in the theater right now. Spill. Spill is about the BP oil spill. And I first came down here with a group of students. I was invited to bring a group of students to study, to teach them the techniques of making this kind of work. But after working on Laramie and after working on Jonestown, I really didn't want to do another piece like this that was based on interviews and that was about a tragedy. I was kind of cooked with that form and that emotional investment too. So I brought the students down and I was teaching them about how do you make art from tragedy, and how do you interview people, and how do you gain their trust? And in the process of being here, I actually went out on a boat trip and came back to Louisiana Wildlife and Fisheries in Grand Isle, and they were autopsying dolphin bodies. It's a pretty dramatic thing to see the dolphin body on a table, and then body bags of dolphins next to it. And it was almost an instant recognition that I had to make a piece about this. It was like, okay, well, life brings you a dolphin autopsy scene, and you, as an artist, I felt, okay, I'm going to have to respond. And that's when I called Riva. Riva's a portrait artist, and I had seen her work, which is also interview-based. And I asked her to collaborate with me to come down and start interviewing people. And I thought we were going to make a piece about the oil spill. But as soon as I got here, I realized that what I knew about the oil industry and the ties between the land and the water and oil here, I knew nothing. And so I had to spend a long time understanding the oil industry, actually investing in trying to tell the narrative of the connection between industry and the land and the water. And so the first act of Spill, which hopefully you'll come see tonight, is about the explosion on the oil rig, and the second act is about the aftermath. But I spent a lot of time trying to, you know, I was at a talk back for Laramie, actually, and somebody asked me, what was I working on? I said, BP oil spill. And the woman said, oh, that's a different kind of sadness. And I was very struck by that. I was like, what do you mean? Oh, that's a different kind of sadness. Almost as if to say that the 11 men who died are an afterthought, or, you know, not victims in the same sense that Matthew Shepard was a victim. And so how do we place a value on human life? And so that's when I sort of, Reeve and I sort of redoubled our efforts to talk to the families who lost their kids and to invest in those narratives. And one of the central characters in Spill is one of the men who died on the rig.
Hi, everyone. I'm Reeva Wortel. I've been working with Leigh, interviewing people and also painting life-size. A lot of the portraits are life-size, and some of them are not full life-size, but just head and shoulders. But I think what I'd just like to tell you about this process is that we interviewed people, and then we would go into the process and start, you know, building trust and relationship with them and hearing their story. And then I would ask them if I could paint their portrait, which most people aren't asked necessarily. And that led us on, the question I posed was, how would you like to be seen? And then that led us on many adventures, because people wanted to be seen. In the case of Carrie St. Pei, he's one of our characters. He wanted to be seen where he grew up, which is near Port Sulphur, and the land is being lost there at a really rapid rate. So he took us out on a boat to where he played as a child, and I painted his portrait there. So that led to a really deep and involved interview with him that we used in the play. So the process of painting the portrait was also dramaturgical in a sense, because it created a lot of interesting conversations that I don't know we would have had if I wouldn't have asked him that question. So. The portraits are on display in the Riley, and then they're also on display inside the theater at the end of the show. So, I think that's... And also, it's interesting to note that people, when I asked them that question, I think because this is... we're speaking of disaster, we're speaking of these issues that affect all of us, and how they are entangled. People, when I would ask them about painting their portrait, they would ask... One of the characters said, don't you have to be dead to have that honor? So mortality became a question, and so that also was a really fascinating process. I'll just leave it at that.
Hi, my name is Kelly Simpkins, and I am a performer in Spill and also a dramaturg. And I've known Leigh for about 15 years and have been working with her. I worked on the Laramie Project and worked on the People's Temple, which is the Jonestown piece. And about a little over 2 years ago, both Reeva and Leigh asked me to come up board on this project, and she's right, it does, we don't make theater a lot of times out of really happy, joyous, triumphant events. These events that are incredibly traumatic and need a voice and need a representative in some ways draw us in, and I really appreciated what you had to say about that. And, you know, part of the beauty for me of doing this kind of work, which is very, very different than playing a fictional character, is the investment that it requires from a performer. We came down here, I think, in April of 2012, and I'd never been here before. And it was a place that I'd always wanted to go just because of the kind of mythology of New Orleans and all the artists that have been down here, and obviously, the kind of resilient nature, or what I presume to be the resilient nature of the community here. And, what I've learned on this project has been incredibly life-changing. So much stuff about the oil industry that I never would have sought out on my own. And about the land loss, and about the history of, what's happened to the land here and the people here, and particularly for me, like getting kind of falling in love with a community down here in the aftermath of a great, great tragedy. So I perform kind of a composite of Leigh and Riva, who are both the creators of this piece, who is called The Writer. And I also perform several other characters, one of whom is Arlene Weissy, who lost her son Adam. He was one of the 11 men who died on the rig, which was the only interview that I was present for. And I play Natalie Rashto, who lost her husband Shane. didn't meet her, that came from a trial transcript. And I play Chad Murray, who was one of the men on the rig who survived, also came from Coast Guard testimony transcripts, and Jory Danos, who was one of the cleanup workers who worked with the Deepwater Horizon. And I got to meet him and have spent a lot of time with him, and he and his wife Jolene are both in this scene. And you know, I guess the thing that happens to me with this kind of work is there is a certain kind of responsibility in playing a human being who is going to potentially come and witness you performing them. And that happened on opening night. Arlene and her family came, and Jory Danos and his family came, and other interviewees have come. And there is nothing like doing that kind of performance. Nothing kind of holds a candle to what that means in terms of the nervousness that I feel and the intense kind of devotion to the integrity of that character. And it's one of the beauties of this work. And I kind of fell in love with Jory. I got to know him pretty immediately from the photographs and just his tape. And it is kind of giving a representation or being a representative of somebody who didn't get a voice. And I think part of the beauty of a lot of this work, as you mentioned, in the talkback, particularly what you said, is that people didn't know. They thought it was a hurricane and that's it. And I think the media comes down in the aftermath of tragedies and disasters like this, and they have an angle. They want a snapshot. They want a little soundbite. They don't want necessarily or seemingly don't want the reality of the situation. They want something that's going to, you know, be able to be said in a headline or by a newscast, or that's going to capture attention in the printed word. And what Riva and Leigh did is, and what we've done with all this work is come down without any agenda, in most cases not even knowing that community or the people or the event, but really learning and coming with an open heart and an open mind and an agendaless, visionless at first, just question and presence. And the gift is, in my opinion, really ours. So it's been an absolute privilege to premiere this play down here and to be part of a representative that is honoring this community in the tragedy that they you know, went through in 2010 and are continuing to go through. So I hope that you all come out and see it tonight, and I'm privileged to be here. Thanks.
Oh, thanks. I'm going to hand this over to Kathy and Nick.
When I walked in this morning, y'all were singing. So I said, well, I'm going to teach y'all a song from the first show we're going to look at. And yeah, if you could just help me out.
Mic.
Oh, on the mic. Come into this open space. Bring your body and your eyes. Remember the things you know. Forget those things you despise. Now, that's a lot of words, but if you just can hum along with me, that would be great. And Nick, I don't know if you can sing while doing tech, and Anneliese too. If y'all could just help sing along while doing tech, that would be great. Come into this open space. Bring your body and your eyes. Remember the things you know. Forget those things you despise. Come into this open space. Bring your body and your eyes. Remember the things you know. Forget those things you despise. Keep going, follow Nick and Anneliese.
Come into this open space.
The things I love.
The
things I hold on to, the things I let go of, the things I know, the things I love, the things I hold on to, the things I let go of, the things I know. Bring your body and your eyes. Remember the things you know. Forget those things you despise. Thank y'all. Give yourselves a round of applause. Nick, if you can get to Asia and Mama Harist. So these first images are from the first, my name again is Kathy. Hi, y'all. I'm from New Orleans. It's nice to be in the capital. thank y'all. This piece, I got to go back a little bit to the first time that I was aware or started paying attention enough to say, I got to make some art about this. Of our disappearing land in South Louisiana was when I started, I developed a relationship with an amazing couple in New Orleans named Joe and Lucianne Carmichael. And they are the stewards of 7 acres of land on the West Bank. And they lived there for many years. They both worked in the New Orleans public school system for most of their lives. And they were also both visual artists. And as they started aging, Lucianne had one son and lost him. And so they started thinking about what would happen to their home as they left this earth. And they're pretty heavy-duty environmentalists and amazing artists. And they decided that they wanted to turn their home into an artist residency that is now called A Studio in the Woods. And and their work, Joe and Lucianne are still with us, and they're both in their 80s. So I would call them a national treasure. So you should go to the Studio in the Woods if you haven't yet and meet them, because, you know, 80s is up there. So I was just got to know them, and Aimee Rogan, a dear friend from high school. Anneliese didn't say this, but Anneliese and I went to grade school together out in Lakeview. And we also went to school with this woman, Aimee Rogan, who's the director of the Studio in the Woods. Started thinking about, okay, we want to make a piece about the loss of land in Louisiana. And then August 29th, 2005 happens, and it is no longer a piece. It is my life and everybody who lives in New Orleans' life and everybody who lives in South Louisiana's life and Baton Rouge's life. Thank y'all for taking us in. And Houston's life and Atlanta's life and everybody's life. I think that's it. Something interesting. I'm realizing we are, ArtSpot does what is now called devised theater, and we use. I'm sorry, that word just came in after I had been in academia, so I'm still getting acclimatized to it. But our primary source material was ourselves, so. We made this piece called Beneath the Strata Disappearing, and I was very intentional about inviting women, all women, except for one, but I'll get to that in a minute, and all native Louisianians. Are you serious?
Over almost. Go ahead. Keep going.
Oh, man. Okay. Well, so the piece... It was really important to have this
to have these women, this work was healing. This was our way of healing ourselves. And we looked at the experience. It ended up being mostly about New Orleans, what had happened in New Orleans, what had happened to New Orleanians. And I guess maybe, Nick, why don't you scroll through some of the photos so they can see them. This woman here is, that you've just been looking at, is Harice Harrison, who was is still with us. She's with the Guardians of the Flame Mardi Gras Indians. And that is, just pause there for a moment. Can you go back? That is a shirt that was my mom's with rust stains from Katrina. Her house got 8 feet of water. You can keep going. I'm just going to talk about the pictures. That's Lisa Shattuck. Go back. She is standing on a tree that fell in the studio in the woods. She created a character that was kind of a composite of herself and the first woman steamboat captain who realized that we needed to learn how to live on water over 100 years ago because the land was not to be trusted. These are the three Kalindas. And our story ended up centering around right here. This is the end of the piece with the beautiful color. Three real estate agents from New Orleans were taking the audience to look at the property of the studio in the woods. And while they were there, eerie things started happening to them. They met ghosts, and they were told, go to another picture, maybe. That's Stephanie McKee, who is the current artistic director of Junebug Productions. She was one of the Kalindas. Give me another one. That's Asetua Amor Amenkum and Gabriel Turner, who was another Kalinda. Asetua is kind of played the earth, the dirt. And she, Asetua is the artistic director of Kambuka African Drum and Dance Collective, and she is a major culture bearer in New Orleans, has studied the relationship of West African culture to New Orleans culture all her life. Okay. I guess I gotta stop. Okay.
Well, Lugaroo came out of this production.
So the African, I just need to finish this one, which is that the Kalinda is a dance from West Africa that that survived the Middle Passage, and that became the power of that piece for me as someone who was undergoing my first major catastrophe, thinking about cultural extinction. How does culture survive? And as was said in the earlier panel, it survives in our bodies, it survives in our songs. There is another character, so we had to bring a man in, and his name is Nick Slie, and he played the Lugaroo, which is a Cajun werewolf, and he represents the insanity that comes to a man who has lost everything. We later developed a piece called Lugaroo that was a solo performance. We took his character from beneath the strata and magnified it and looked at a man who's lost many family generations of family members to working in the oil industry. And just the madness of the disappearance of his home. The wolf is becoming extinct. And then Nick has led us all in the third piece of the trilogy, which is called Cry You One, and I'm going to stop talking.
Thank you, Kathy.
I'm just going to sit right here, and I'll give it as brief as I can. Nick Slie from New Orleans and Gramercy, Louisiana. And Lugaroo was installed in an abandoned city golf course and city park at sunrise and sunset. It was performed in New Orleans for a while, and then we took it on the road. And when we took it out on the road, we were like, how's this Louisiana-specific story going to engage with anyone? And we found that the extractive industries, the story of Louisiana, is really resonant. And for the last piece that we've kind of conceived of as a trilogy now, we did a production in October called Cry You One, which is both a live performance and an online storytelling platform to tell the story of the people most directly impacted by coastal land loss. And so just to show you a few images from that piece, this is in the middle of a field that you first arrive in about 30 minutes in, and the woman standing on top of that palmetto hut is Monique Verdan, amazing filmmaker, artist, native Homa Indian. And just gonna scroll through these to let you see some of the landscape we were working in. This is on top of the Leffe, adjacent to the central wetlands where people came with us on.
So how long did people walk, a mile?
It was 1.7 miles from start to finish. The piece sort of happens on top of the levee and then into installations on the side of the wetlands. So it's a kind of combination of small groups, an ensemble generated and devised pieces that we share together as the group. This is the assistant district attorney of Louisiana throwing down on top of the levee. Always love that picture. And this is an example of the really fabulous designer Jeff Becker's work, who put up a number of these large frames. It says Last Land Before the Sea. And he spent some time framing up the sort of natural landscape in a number of places. We worked on the piece for about 12 to 18 months, and now the piece continues. It's going to tour to 6 locations across the country. We continue to work with all of the partners and the people that we engaged along the process. And right now we're currently part of a Gulf Coast tour working with this organization called Gulf Futures. So where we're working with people who are doing direct policy work around these issues, using our storytelling and music and the forms we used in the piece to listen to people about what they want to happen with the Restore Act money that's going to come from BP. So we're culminating that mini Gulf Coast tour in April, and then we'll go out on the road across the country.
Thanks. Kathy, I wanted, and Nick, I thought I'd
show
I have a couple of
pictures.
Oh, we have some more pictures.
Just while we're talking.
I had some kind of framing questions that actually you all answered a lot, and those questions were how are these performances able to resist national storying of the disasters, and almost all of you mentioned that, oh, and we brought this over here, they thought it was just a hurricane, or I have to say, as a New Orleanian watching BP, the spill piece, I was very ignorant of the events that led up to the explosion and the people impacted by that. It's the spill was more my news and what I was more in tune with. So each of these pieces, how you all complicate or resist some of the national stories of these plays, and also take advantage of what is it that live performance can do that other media cannot. And you mentioned that in the interview with Mold, that the minute you walk in, for people who are New Orleanian, they're going to, it has a very physical reaction, as you almost want to wheeze, as you said, when you walk on that set. But I'm going to, Kathy, and for Nick, so in ways of resisting this sort of national storying, you all have very site-specific pieces, especially this last piece where we're taken out about an hour out of New Orleans, isn't it, Violet, about 50 minutes or 45 minutes, and yet have found a way to have other ways to engage with this project outside of that the piece that's tied to the land. And I'm as a one thing that you all spoke about before in our own conversations about, as a New Orleanian, even though this is nearby and literally not far, the end of our coastline is not far, but New Orleanians, we tend to get, and maybe in Baton Rouge as well, in other parts of Louisiana, a bit isolated or we don't really see it. So I'm just kind of curious if you could talk a little bit about negotiating, even as a New Orleanian, of a bit of that outsider-insider status as you work with those communities, and either of you want to talk about that.
Well, Nick is more of an insider in St. Bernard because he has been teaching at the Nunez Community College there for about 10 years now. And so I guess I was more in the outsider position there. But I think that you become an insider pretty quick. I think the act of listening is a huge part of of moving from an outsider to an insider, identifying. For me, I Monique is also from, Monique Verdun is from St. Bernard. And so everywhere we went, she knew somebody. But those are kind of the positives of having entree because of knowing people who are family. Some of the, I guess, negatives or challenges are, you know, sometimes the closer you are, the heavier the heat of the conflict. And so St. Bernard and New Orleans are right next to each other. And St. Bernard Parish, per land base per capita, suffered more damage than New Orleans did post Katrina, and yet didn't get hardly any attention from the national media. So, and had many of the same problems with FEMA and Road Home and all of that. So, you know, I think there's still sore relations around that between those our two communities.
If I might talk a bit about
yes,
narrative.
Yes.
I think one of the problems in what happened in New Orleans is that it's never happened in the United States before. We've never lost a city. And so when I tried to write about it, I had to look at models from Germany after the war, from Japan after the Kobe earthquake, Russia after Chernobyl, to see how their writers tried to address the destruction of an entire city. Yeah, because it never happened in the United States before, when the reporters got here, they had to reach for some narrative form that already existed. And the hurricane story is a three-part story that everybody gets. And the first day, it's the idiot reporter leaning into the wind saying, yeah, it's really blowing here. And then the second day, it's a couple on the slab of their house weeping and saying always, but at least we have our lives to be thankful for. And the third act, the third day, is they're starting to rebuild. Well, in the case of what happened to us, on the third day, we were still trapped on our rooftops waiting for the United States to show up, and they were still 2 days away. So there was no narrative structure anybody could reach for to make sense of all these disparate pieces of information. Even with goodwill, they couldn't do it. And on the other side, the audiences couldn't make sense of it either, because they didn't have a structure to put this information. One thing that's helpful in thinking about writing about such disasters is that a novel like War and Peace was written 60 years after the French invaded Russia. A Journal of the Plague Year was written a century after the Black Death. So it takes a long time to develop a narrative form to communicate what's going on. It may be why we have no lasting work yet about 9/11. It's just too soon. And then the other thing, which I think bears on the Laramie Project, is there is a war that goes on between conflicting narratives, between conflicting stories. One of the biggest single expenditures of the Corps of Engineers after the disaster here was to hire a PR firm in Manhattan. And it was money well spent, because their narrative prevailed, that it was our own damn fault for living in a city below sea level. And they did everything they could, but how could they save people like that, right? Especially Black people like that? And that war of narrative, I think, is a crucial one. And I think what thing the Laramie Project attempted to focus on was another kind of story for what happened. I don't know if you'd like to speak about that.
Yeah, I can speak about that a little bit. I think it's present in the case of the BP oil spill as well, because BP has spent millions and millions and millions of dollars to teach the rest of the country that it's over here and that nobody's suffering, and even talk about, there's a character in the play who says it's like giving a man water when he's drowning. But the ads that they've taken out, and the New York Times full page ads about that they're the victim, that there's all these false claims and, you know, spillionaires from this and things like, I mean, our experience, I'm sure there were false claims, and I'm sure that, you know, they, in from what we've studied, they willingly gave away money to make it look like they were paying out claims. But the people who had legitimate claims, they were being offered $5,000 or $25,000 to sign away their rights to a legit claim. And if you're a fisherman who looks at, you know, who understands what's happening out there, and, you know, as an oysterman said to us, you know, there's no spats, so that's our future. You know, how long for this to come back? 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, ever? So I'm going to take your $5,000 or $25,000 and sign away my right to a legit claim. So anyway, the propaganda machine and how does history get told? You know, and that is something that happened with Laramie, where we went back to Laramie 10 years after the crime, and the town said it wasn't a hate crime. It was a drug deal gone bad. And suddenly the prevailing narrative was that he wasn't killed because he was gay. And you know, I remember a 20-year-old on the University of Wyoming campus saying that to me, and I said, you know, but do you understand that, you know, the perpetrators hit Matthew Shepard with the butt of a gun 21 times in the head? And she said, no, I never heard that part. So it's just a very interesting question of how history gets told and who owns that history and how does that narrative get constructed over time. And, you know, I don't know, for me, I feel that our work is in part like a document. It's the words of the people, it's the actual words of the people, and it's at least on the record. You know, it's at least part of the dialogue about how history gets told and how history gets written.
Thanks. I wanted to just kind of build on that. What is it about this as opposed to a documentary film, for example, that engages the audience in a different way or can reach into places that perhaps another medium wouldn't? And I would love to hear your thoughts on that.
Sure. I mean, I think what distinguishes, people talk about our theater as docudrama, and they talk about it as verbatim theater. And I always kind of am taken aback by that, because if you listened verbatim to the interviews we conducted, there is nothing theatrical about them and very little that's interesting about them. So it's not verbatim. It's the words of the people, but they're heavily edited and they're not word perfect. And, you know, the idea of a documentary, I think, imposes a kind of idea that this is factual, or that the function of it is to convey factual information. And we're pretty rigorous about, you know, fact-checking and making sure that what we're putting out there is factual, but we're actually trying to make art. We're actually trying to make an artistic representation of an event. And so I like to, it feels almost like you know, a little bit of like being confined to the idea of documentary theater that I've spent a lot of time trying to distance myself. Like I, you know, the chairs fly in our piece and different things happen that, you know, that aren't real and that aren't, you know, just based on the facts. So, and I guess the other thing I would say about that is that, you know, Tony Kushner said, which sort of always haunts me, probably will haunt me for the rest of my life, but he said the audience can only follow 7 characters. If you give them more than 7 characters, your play is never going to work. And every play I've ever written has, you know, 30, 40, 50 characters. But it's really about the community becomes the protagonist. So the ensemble is loosely wearing the clothes of the various characters and taking on and off and taking on their voices. But it's really about the community talking as opposed to different individual protagonists.
As Spill and your trilogy and Cryuan leave the Gulf Coast and perform in other areas, and some for you and for you all have already experienced some of that, I'm curious what for each of you maybe to talk a little bit about what do you think the pulse will be, how open the further we move away from the levee breaks disaster. I'm curious, like, is there, oh, that's done, you know, I'm just curious about what, how much interest there is to hear these stories and to know more about the truth. Yeah, we could start. Yeah, we could just move down the line.
Well, you didn't get to see the images from Lou Guru. Sorry about that. But we actually toured Lou Guru the summer that the oil was gushing, and Nick and I was happy to be gone because I had a 4-year-old daughter at the time, and I was scared of what the air in New Orleans was going to do to her lungs. And Nick felt like he really wanted to be present on the ground witnessing what was happening. But I would offer that everywhere we went, it was, you know, it was like we were a little piece of what was happening in Louisiana, live and in person, talking to people. And the place where the pulse was the strongest was when we went to the border of New York and Pennsylvania, where fracking was just starting to, the fracking battle was just starting to happen with our really dear friends at the North American Cultural Laboratory Theater, one of whom, Tanis Kowalczyk, owns an independent farm. And she, while we were there, a fracking machine had been erected, not, you know, in full view of her farm. And she had no idea what that was going to do to the groundwater for their vegetables and her child. So, and then maybe, Nick, why don't you want to talk about Clear Creek and the connections we're making with Clear Creek and Sandglass?
Yeah, I guess I just think that's the story of who was going to predict that there was going to be two hurricanes in New York City in 4 years. I mean, who is going to predict any of the things that are going on? One of the things we've been talking about is what happens to a dynamic natural system when you just graft a human-built idea on it. And if we want to say, people say we're crazy for living in Louisiana, try Phoenix or even Atlanta. You know, like, we have a natural resource next to us, the Mississippi River. You know, there are so many communities that don't have that natural resource. And so I feel like why there is even interest other than relationships that exist in the work touring to other places is I think people do recognize that by now, some folks in New Orleans, that while we don't understand at all, had to figure some things out that are valuable to other people. In the same way that it'll be really valuable for our life in New Orleans to be in Putney, Vermont, which was flooded by Irene, but is also moving on a transition movement to another type of energy, you know. So I feel like the dialogue's pretty robust because New Orleans, Louisiana, we're canary in the coal mine, you know. And so I personally feel like that's the interest that I have and we have, is like that dialogue is robust because it's needed. One last thing, Ricardo Levins Morales, if anyone knows him, he's a brilliant organizer from Minneapolis. He said to me one day, he said, "You guys in New Orleans ready to go when the big earthquake happens in San Francisco?" And I was like, that sounds so repulsive to me, you know. And he was like, no. He's like, you don't understand what you all understand about disaster now, and you need to be prepared, because when other people in your big American community are going to be experiencing these disasters, how are you going to go apply what you know to the future? So I think he got me thinking about that.
My new play is called Broomstick. It's The Confessions of a Witch. It's a one-woman show. And the whole thing's written in rhymed iambic pentameter. It's just about being an old woman. And it seems to me about the potentially the most independent a human being could possibly be. Because you've seen everything, done everything, know everything, and apparently don't need a man for anything. So it just premiered at New Jersey Repertory in an extended run. And they decided to do my trilogy in staged readings on the dark nights, on Monday nights. And they had exactly the same experience with their audiences that we had with mold last year. This is 8 years after the flood. People would watch the first act, come out with their families or friends at intermission, and we'd see them trying to go back in for the second act, and they couldn't go with their friends, and they'd sit in the lobby during the second act because they couldn't bear to sit through it. The same thing happened in New Jersey because of Hurricane Sandy. People would buy their tickets for the trilogy, and then they'd call the theater and say, "We're sitting at the kitchen table, and we can't make ourselves get in the car." So I think Nick is absolutely right, and as I said before, New Orleans is simply where the future arrived first. These are not local plays. These plays are about what happens if you don't pay attention to the environment.
Thank you. Is there anything for you all, future stagings of Spill, or how you think it'll be? Are people ready to hear the story?
I mean, I'll just say one thing that's maybe a little different than what these guys have said. That for us, when people read Spill, from a dramaturgical mind, they think about the dramatic narrative, right? And it's very, very dramatic that a rig blows up and that the guys jump overboard into, you know, 20 feet below to the sea. And, you know, it didn't take us long being here for people to start talking about land loss. It's like this. It's like, yes, you're here to talk about the oil spill, but you have to understand this. This place is disappearing. It's like this, you know, the second thing out of their mouths. And so trying to weave that narrative in, and also the fact that, you know, whatever, depending on what study you read, that 50 to 80% of the coastal erosion is due to the cutting of canals for the oil industry, right? So there's a big lawsuit in play. But I've heard, when I try to talk about land loss in Spill or write about land loss in Spill, that my narrative is meandering and that piece needs to go away so that the drive of the, you know, the rig disaster can, and I've heard that many, many times from many people that I respect and admire. So I think that it's that idea of what you're saying, right? The future arrived here first. It's almost like people don't want to take that in. That, you know, people living in any coastal city in America are going to face this very same dilemmas, you know, within our lifetimes, not in some distant, remote time. You know, an environmentalist we talked to said, in 100 years, Baton Rouge will be the coast. When we visited with him this time, he said, I changed that to 50 years. And Louisiana is, you know, now the highest sea level rise in the world. So it's you know, this is, it's very uncomfortable. I mean, Al Gore wrote an Inconvenient Truth. It's still inconvenient, and it's, you know, blaring all around us. But it's you know, there, I have experienced some resistance to that truth inside of Spill. Yes.
Can I just give you a couple of, for those of you who are not from this area, a couple of quick measures of what's happened? In the last 60 years, Louisiana has lost as much square mileage as the entire state of Delaware. We lost Delaware. When I was a child, we were taught there was 100 miles between the Gulf of Mexico and New Orleans. My children were taught there were 50. Today, it's 12 miles to the east. Right? While we're sitting here talking, since this began, 3 football fields of Louisiana have fallen into the Gulf of Mexico. Right? That's how quickly this is happening.
Thank you. I want to open it up for, if you all, if anyone would like to ask questions. I don't want to hog them. Yes. If you want a mic, you just want to talk loud.
I heard the NPR interview on Spill, and I agree with you in terms of, like, you know, how do we, it's people's stories that you're cultivating. It's not, you know, I mean, I think for the lack of, I'm sorry.
No, just for the documentation.
I think it's that pedestrian aspect that people are trying to codify what sometimes artists are cultivating. But in the end, it's people's stories. You know, the process with Moises Kaufman and, you know, doing that. I mean, I adapted that process, but that's always been an integral process of any immigrant. You collect your family stories, you know. And each one of us probably in our families were the ones that were that gravitated to collecting our stories. It was my grandmother who endowed upon me that I had to tell our story. So, you know, these things like docudrama and, you know, they're, in many ways they're pedestrian, you know, terminologies that are trying to codify something that's extremely intrinsic, like telling a story, you know, in inventive ways. And I heard about Spill, and I, come on, as this happened here, I mean, we become the epicenter of both man-made and natural disasters, right? When we got hit in 2010 with the Spill, it was basically the nearing the 5th anniversary of the storm. And, you know, I was away at the time, and I was like, oh, it was very painful. But it's happening everywhere. The spills are taking place. And we just had another spill, and they suppress it here because this is an oil state, you know? So, I mean, just thank you for doing that kind of work, because when you say that, and John, you said something really, again, you know, the war of narrative, right? Who's the narrative, right? Who's dealing that narrative? And, you know, in Exxon, after the Exxon Valdez, like 6 months afterwards, Exxon was putting out commercials about, you know, everything that they were doing, and they put out commercials about their gasoline, and it looked like Chardonnay, right? Like when it was, you know, it gets filled, right? It does. It looks like Chardonnay, like you could drink it, like everything just went away. And basically here, you know, BP acts like it's just went away. I mean, I deal with the Brujo character when I bring in everything that's green with the BP Oil's book, because, you know, it's up to us to be able to tell the narrative. So how is it, the question would be, how is it that these narratives eventually reach that universal concern?
Is that a question for anyone?
I mean, for all of you, because okay. It's always, you know, if it's going to survive, it's got to be universal, right?
Okay, so what I'm hearing is that we have, yes, this is a very, we have an urgent message. I love the canary vision, the future, New Orleans is the future of everywhere else. So how do we keep these stories being told? And what we heard was there was already resistance. And Reva, yes. Did you want to add anything?
Well, what you're saying is just making me think that I'm from Portland, Oregon, and there's a lot of environmentalists there, a lot of action, fantastic people. But I've gone back to visit family, and I tell this story because I feel like it's just a deep irony that we're all living with. I was driving, and there was a person in front of me with a bumper sticker that said, "Stop offshore drilling." And I thought, wow, that person is driving a car and they're saying stop offshore drilling, you know, which is fine. I believe in that free speech. It's fine. But still, let's talk about it, right? And oil, and that's the thing that I think that we've been really struck by as someone who, I guess, would be more on the environmentalist side of things, coming into this story and really understanding oil in a really intimate way. And I think a dramaturgical device we use is, we thought we were going to tell the story of the spill. But actually, in order to do that, we had to track the oil, and the oil came from the Macondo. So we had to go to the Macondo. We had to go to those guys. We had to go to those guys right there at that well to start to really get, because it's such an invisible thing in our culture and our society. We don't think about it in that way. So in order to have a relationship with it, and to feel connected and not just judgmental of those men that work out there extracting that oil and all the judgments that an environmentalist or someone like me that would have about that, because I don't know anything about it, I think that, to me, that is really what the unraveling of oil and how that is the thing that connects us. And I feel like to be really honest about that, instead of pretending like, oh, well, I'm not really into oil. I'm just going to drive my car, or those kinds of things. I mean, that sounds sort of ridiculous, right? But that's true. When we leave here, people are like, well, why were people upset about the moratorium? People say that in New York. Like, why didn't they want that? I mean, people died. Why wouldn't you want that? And it's because it's the economy. These are people's lives. These are families that are making money. That's why they didn't want that to happen. And I think making those connections, which now, you know, they seem so obvious, they're not obvious in places like Portland, Oregon, and New York, and away from here. So I think it's actually really profound to take this story and take it to other places and have a dialogue, because people are shocked. We were in Boulder, Colorado. People there were like, what? They were so shocked about the story of the spill. And so I actually think, you know, saying to Leigh, like, it's so important, like, for our hearts to be here in Louisiana and to be with the people and to have the interviewees come and to have this experience. But the thing is that I feel like it's almost like we came and we premiered it here to get permission, in a way, to now go and take the stories to the rest of the world. So that's really, I think it's really important. That's a great, yes.
It's just for the documentation. Is it okay? It's for the documentation. If that's all right. This is as far as she goes.
It's not really a question, actually, or maybe it's a question for you as well as for the group, because I'm a storyteller also, and I've often had that response, like, why, like you're saying in this, I think you said about the second act, people feel like, oh, it's going places, they're not really sure. But at the same time, I think that there is a part of the work that you do and what others do, that we're inviting the audience along to hear a story in a different way. So we have the first part that's about almost thinking about it almost cinematically. We have the big disaster, and now we're going in and we're seeing the individual lives. And while I understand that, because I hear that as a conversation about, oh, it can't go here, and then it goes there. But in a way, it sort of follows the track of the disaster. It goes there, and it goes there, and then it goes right there. And I think to that individual, and I think there is tremendous value in challenging an audience to stay with you through the details and not just link on to the big glob of story, but now just kind of deconstruct it down to its hair follicles and ask people to pay attention. So I commend that, the courage it takes to follow that artistic choice. And I hope that we all follow it right to the box office and see the show.
Kathy, you want to help me on the other side?
Can I say one thing about...
Oh, yes, Nick.
This is all gloom and doom, but we live amongst the most joyous people in the history of the planet. And I just want to say that I have faith. My faith is that we've been assimilating, changing, transitioning story, ways of fiddling, playing the horn, making food for 250, 300 years, and there were people here doing it before that. And while the situation is dire, if anyone is trained at this moment in history to deal with and survive through this, I think unequivocally the people of Southeast Louisiana, Baton Rouge, wherever, even Northern Louisiana, I think people in Louisiana are... Or no diss to my people. It's two different states, above I-10 and below I-10. Everybody knows it. It's two different states. I said it. But you know what I mean, Jose? I think you're so right on, man, because it's like we have the skills to do it. We need to get away from trying to formalize and codify them so much and breathe and be the people that we are, I think.
And I just wanted to say, you were talking about coming and performing for playing the people that you're performing for them. Well, Nick's character in Cry You Want is Tommy Dulac, and he is a man who works in the oil industry and is thinking about ways to use the oil industry to help with the land loss problem. And often in the performance, he would have relatives or friends, and as the older the relative, the more often you would hear, Nick, tell me this. They wouldn't refer to him in character. They would make him himself. And yeah. It was awesome.
One thing I would petition you, really important for you to know, and I don't know if you noticed, just for the oil spill,
Latino immigrants did a lot of that cleaning. Know that the fishermen, the Cajun fishermen that were brought out there, they got sick. They got contaminated by the oil. It was a big media firestorm, so they pulled them away. And then I interviewed immigrants, and Latino immigrants started cleaning. And they would, and if they once the videos got out there, they wouldn't show their bodies. They would just show show the bottoms of them, and they wouldn't even give them the proper equipment. They gave them plastic bags to walk in.
Yeah, that comes up in spill.
So I was hoping, when I was listening, I was like, I hope they know that some Latino immigrants clean that stuff.
I'm hoping, is there a character in there, sir?
There's a lot more to say, but I do want to just bring out, for each of these pieces, there are 7 pieces that were on the table and talking about these big issues, and just thank you so much for bringing your openness and generosity and knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you, Anneliese. Thank you.
So we're going to transition very quickly, actually, into a performance from Teatro Luna, all-female Latino performance troupe from Chicago, doing a 30-minute excerpt from Generation Sex. So we're just going to move some chairs and all sorts of things are going to happen. So just stay with us, though. All you two out there on online land, too.